Well, good morning, Harvest. How's everybody today? I am fired up. Worship with you fires me up, and fired up to be with your campuses all across Chicagoland. How about all of us in Elgin give a big welcome to everybody on the other side of the camera and the Harvest family? Love all you guys so much. So I serve a church in Southern California in Anaheim, so thank you for the warm welcome to Chicago this weekend. And because I actually have lived in Illinois most of my life, but I've become a wimp since I moved to California. And I'm used to palm trees and sunshine. I live, our church is in Anaheim, where we have the Ducks hockey team, the Angels baseball team, and Mickey Mouse, and the most happiest place on earth is in Anaheim. So if you get out that way, I hope you'll come see us. And let me just get this out of the way, because I know what most of you have never heard me speak before. And right now, I know what you're wondering in your mind. You're thinking this. You're going like, Gene, is that your real voice? You didn't have to laugh. And do you really sound that way? I'd give your audio team $100 if they could make me sound like Barry White today. You know, kind of, Jesus loves you, baby. Something like that. But instead, when God was handing out voices, I got one that sounds like I've been inhaling helium for 4 days. So that's what you're stuck with today. Hey, I want to say a quick word, if I could, if it's okay with you, just kind of about the chapter, the rocky, tumultuous, uncertain times that you find yourself navigating as a church, as people who love Jesus and people of faith. As some of you may know, I was a part of a church a few miles just down the road from here in South Barrington for a few years and served on the staff there. And so I know a little something about church trauma and the hurt and the confusion and the grief and the fear and how it takes a long time to kind of sort it all out and process it and heal. And I just want you to know, I'm pulling and praying for you. I'm pulling and praying for all Chicagoland churches and all of you. I really am. There's always going to be a huge piece of my heart here. Some of the best people I know, including my son and daughter-in-law, live in Chicagoland. And a lot of people have found hope and heaven and Jesus Christ through this church. And you inspire me with your resilience and your reliance on Him. And I'm just so humbled to be here this weekend. And I'm really here for one reason, and that's because your coming interim teaching pastor, Dave Stone, who's teaching next weekend, by the way, and who's going to start joining you more regularly beginning in June, asked me to come. And Dave doesn't know I'm going to say this, but Dave and I have been friends for over 30 years. He's one of my closest friends on the planet. And we have shared some wonderful mountaintop experiences in life, joy-filled experiences, but he and his wife, Beth, have also been there with my wife, Barbara, and I when we've walked through some valleys, when we've walked through some painful days with an arm around the shoulder, and they have encouraged us in some ways you will ever, never know. And here's what I can tell you about your future in the months ahead with him. You're going to be blessed by a Bible teacher who is one of the kindest, most humble, gentle, loving, high-character people I have ever known in my life. And just as he's walked with Barbara and I with an arm around the shoulder through difficult seasons, he's going to walk with you into your future, and you're going to be blessed by that. Amen? Amen. So if you have your Bible today, let's open to the book of Acts, the 10th chapter. We're going to come to that in a moment. Years ago, when Bobby Kennedy was furiously fighting for the Democratic nomination for president, he spent one unusually hot, humid spring day in April in New York City, crisscrossing the neighborhoods of Spanish Harlem. And at the end of the day, he was soaked in perspiration. He was caked in dirt. And his guide, who was kind of showing him around there that day, asked him, he said, "Why do you come here so often? Why do you, an affluent, privileged guy, you know, who's grown up with wealth your whole life, why do you come to this ghetto so often?" And Bobby Kennedy said this. He said, "Because I found out something I never knew before. I found out that my world was not the real world. I found out that my world was not the real world." I grew up in a small town, central Illinois, predominantly white, conservative, pastor's home. And when I was 25 years old, I moved to Las Vegas and became the pastor of a church there. Quite a change. Some of you didn't even know there were churches in Las Vegas, right? I mean, Las Vegas church sounds like an oxymoron, doesn't it? You know, like two words don't go together, like jumbo shrimp or white chocolate or Microsoft Works. And I didn't know what church in Las Vegas was going to be like. You know, were they going to have Elvis impersonators doing the prelude? You know, girls in bikinis announcing hymn numbers, you know, kind of like Fight Night with the tithe machines in the lobby. I didn't know. I spent the next 18 years of my life in Las Vegas, and I discovered something that I never knew in my growing up years. I found out that my world was not the real world. At least my world was only a small, narrow slice of the real world. You see, growing up in my hometown of Lincoln, Illinois, I really didn't have to confront my feelings about people who were different than me religiously, different than me ethnically, different than me economically, politically, sexually, because I really didn't know people who were different than me. I didn't have to confront my feelings about people of other races and skin colors because I didn't have any significant relationships with people of other ethnicities. I didn't have to confront my feelings about people who followed other major world religions because I really didn't know anybody that followed other major world religions. I didn't have to confront my feelings about people in the LGBTQ community because I really didn't think I knew anybody in the LGBTQ community. At least I didn't think that I did. I always thought, well, they're out there somewhere. And then I moved to Las Vegas and found out they were out there. And those years in Vegas became so good for me and redefined my whole life and approach to ministry because I had to wrestle in a fresh way with what did Jesus really mean when he said in Matthew 19, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Honestly, that was a lot easier to do in my hometown because my neighbors were a lot like me. But in Vegas, that became a new challenge for me because Jesus didn't put any qualifiers on that verse. He didn't put any asterisks or prerequisites to that verse. Jesus didn't say, well, love your neighbor if he dresses like you or if your neighbor believes like you do, if your neighbor lives a lifestyle like you or your neighbor votes like you or whatever. He just said, love your neighbor as yourself, period. No qualifier, no prerequisite, no asterisk. Jesus says, just treat them even if they are different than you with love. See, one of the areas I've been growing in my life, and I've needed to grow in my life, is to understand that God's heart and God's house, God's love, God's son, God's grace is genuinely for everyone. And you say, well, Gene, where do you come up with that crazy idea? Well, like right out of Scripture. Like on the day the church began, when Peter stands up in Jerusalem before thousands of spiritually wayward people, and he announces in Acts 2:21 that everyone, notice that word, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And then if you keep turning right in your Bible a little bit, you come to Romans chapter 1, verse 16, we find where the Apostle Paul says there, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to, everyone say it, everyone who believes, to the Jews first, and also to the Greek. This isn't an exclusive kind of thing. It's for everyone. And then you keep turning right in your Bible, and you get to 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, where it says, the Lord is patient with you, not wishing that any should perish, but that, say it, all should reach repentance. Are you seeing a theme there in Scripture? So I find, here's what it's truth about me. I find that I possess this dark, depraved, sinful nature inside of me to often take the plank in my eye and I use it to build a wall between myself and people who are different than me. And that's why I'm so challenged and convicted and inspired by an event that's recorded for us in Acts chapter 10, where we see a side of the Apostle Peter that is uncomfortable for us, that we're not used to seeing. Let me give you a little context. Even though Peter was handpicked by Jesus to be a leader and an apostle in the church, Even though Peter was there on the day when the words rolled off of Jesus' lips, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, meaning all people groups, all ethnic groups. Even though Peter was the one who stood up on the day of Pentecost and said those words, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. In spite of all of that, Peter was a deeply prejudiced guy. And he was deeply prejudiced against anybody that wasn't a part of his ethnic group, the Jews, his clique that he had grown up with. He was brought up in an atmosphere that had led him to believe that anybody who wasn't a Jew was less than human. That if you were out in public and you brushed up against a non-Jewish person, you needed to go home and to decontaminate yourself. He was taught that you never helped a Gentile woman at a time of childbirth because that was bringing just another non-Jew into the world. He'd grown up in an environment that taught you would never go into the home of a Gentile or invite a Gentile into your home because that would defile you. And so in the first 10 years of church history, did you know there's no record of anyone communicating the good news of amazing grace through Jesus, the gospel, to a single Gentile? And that was comfortable for Peter. That felt safe for Peter. You see, all of us have this instinctive dark nature that Peter had to develop these planks in our eyes where we use them to build walls between ourselves and people who are different than us. For some, it's the wall we build between people of different skin colors, whether they be black or white or Asian or Latino or Jew or Arab or Eastern European or whatever it is. For some, it's political liberals that you just can't stand. For others, it's political conservatives that make your blood boil. For some, it's the body tattoo covered, body pierced individual who looks so different than you. For others, it's the graying senior who you think so out of touch in a world of iPhones, iPads, and text messaging. For some, it's the person who follows a different religion school of thought, whether it's Buddhism and Mormonism or Hinduism, Judaism, Islam, New Age kinds of beliefs. For some, it's the person who's HIV infected. I'll never forget one time I was watching a softball game at a local park with some friends and sitting in the bleachers. There were a lot of people up in the bleachers, and I was up at the very top, and I couldn't help but eavesdrop on the conversation that the people were having right on the rows in front of me, and I was just listening. Don't look at me like you've never done that. You've all done that. And so I'm listening, and they were basically recounting their lifestyle of the last few weeks. And the last few weeks was basically get up, go to work, go party after work, find somebody to sleep with that night, go to bed, get up, go to work, go party after work, find somebody else to sleep with the next night, get up. And it was just this cycle over and over again. So I'm listening to this conversation. I'm just back here, and I can just hear them talking all about their life cycle. Do you know what was going on inside of me? I didn't find my heart breaking. I didn't find myself thinking, oh, if only they knew how much they were loved by God. I didn't find myself thinking, oh, I could be in the same cycle they are, you know, searching for meaning, coming up empty, were it not for the grace of God in my life. Here's what I found myself thinking. I'm sure thankful I'm not like them. And I leaned over to a friend who was sitting next to me. And I said, you're not going to believe the conversation down here. And I just repeated the conversation like I just told for you. And then here's what I said. Gene Appel, your guest speaker today. Here's what I said, word for word. I'm not proud of this. I wouldn't blame you if you lose all respect for me. I said, they're a bunch of sleazeballs. And my friend turned to me and said, you know, Gene, every time I'm in an environment like this, I think, this is where Jesus would be. These are the people he would be hanging out with, trying to love, trying to influence. And I'm telling you, God used those words. It was like the Holy Spirit sent a dart of conviction right into my heart. I remember just dropping my face into my hands, just saying, Gene, what is the matter with you? You stand up every weekend and tell thousands of people how much God loves them. And you, of all people, you're not loving very well right now. You know, from time to time, we all know stories all too well of a pastor that's had to resign because of a moral failure. And usually a moral failure might refer to a sexual sin or a financial sin of some kind. But you know something I've never heard of? I've never heard of a pastor that had to resign because of a lack of love. Because for some reason, we don't equate a lack of love as a moral failure. But I'll tell you who does. God does. A few years before, my wife Barbara and I moved away from Las Vegas. We moved into a neighborhood that forced us to deal with our attitudes, our natural inclination to take the planks in our eyes and build walls between ourselves and people who were different. Our neighborhood was just so eclectic. Get this. In the house that lived directly behind us, like our backyards, you know, butted up each to other, was a Mormon family. On this side of us was a Hindu family. Straight across the street from us was a Jewish family. And then on this side of our house was just your basic Las Vegas heathen family. And they had two Mercedes in the driveway. He was an attorney, and she was a topless dancer in a Las Vegas show. And our kids played with their kids every day. What do you do with that, Christian people? You see, something I've learned over the years and something Peter has to discover is that while we have this instinctive nature to take the plank in our eyes and build walls with them, God needs us to take those planks and build bridges to people who are different than us. And so now we come to our text in Acts 10, where we encounter a man who was not a Jew. He was not a part of Peter's ethnic group. He was not an insider. He was not a part of Peter's clique. His name was Cornelius, verse 1. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion. He's a soldier of what was known as the Italian cohort. He was a devout man who feared God with all his household, gave alms generously to the poor, and he prayed continually to God. So here's this military guy, and though he was not a Christian, though he did not know about Jesus, obviously he had an awareness of God. It says he prayed to God. He was generous and provided for under-resourced people. And if Cornelius had died, my guess is somebody would have stood up at his funeral and said, oh, if anybody's in heaven, it's Cornelius, because he was such a great guy. But Cornelius and his family were spiritually lost. If they weren't, there would be no need for this chapter in the Bible. There would be no need for God to ask Peter to go build a bridge to him. And the only thing sadder than the fact that Cornelius and his family was lost, that was up to this point in church history, nobody cared that they were lost. In fact, especially we know Peter didn't care. Because Cornelius wasn't like him. He wasn't one of his people. And so God gives Cornelius, this Gentile, a vision. Verse 3. At about the ninth hour of the day, or it was 3 in the afternoon, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God come in and say to him, Cornelius. And he stared at him in terror and said, what is it, Lord? And he said to him, your prayers and your alms have ascended as a memorial before God. And now send men to Joppa and bring one Simon, who's called Peter. He's lodging with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea. He sees an angel of God. Now, I'm from Anaheim, so when I think of angels, we think of Mike Trout and our baseball team there, but this is not the kind of angel that he's talking about. The angel instructs Cornelius, Cornelius, send some of your soldiers south to the city of Joppa, which is right on the sea. You're going to find Peter there, who's staying in the house of a tanner named Simon. And so he does that. Now, Peter has no idea that God is about to do some quadruple bypass surgery on his heart for people who are different than him. God is just so good at taking things we have resisted all of our lives and bringing us face to face with them. In our neighborhood, God brought us face to face with these neighbors who were so different than us. And we especially started to get to know and get close to our Jewish neighbors across the street and the heathens who live next door to us, because we had kids the same age. And those of you who've had kids, you've understand that, how kids start playing together and you just start hanging out and you get to know each other. And so we started to get to know them, and they would go on vacation and ask us to get their newspaper in their mail, and let me tell you, there is some interesting subscriptions in their mail. And they'd have birthday parties for their kids, and so they'd invite us over, you know, to the heathens next door's birthday party, and they'd invite other friends. And just so you can kind of understand the context of the world that was in, there were a lot of surgically enhanced people at these birthday parties, okay? But you know what started happening to us as we started to get to know our neighbors? We kind of started to like them. They started to matter to us. In fact, we started to love them. And it was as if God was saying to us, do you get it? Do you get it? Do you get it? The next day, while Cornelius' guys are en route, Peter goes up on the roof to pray. Many of you are familiar with this scene. He's hungry. He starts dreaming about food, and you can read it in the context. There's like this large sheet that gets lowered down from heaven. It's like a parachute, and there's all kinds of food items on it that a good kosher Jew would never eat. And then Peter hears a voice say these words. Look at verse 13. Rise, Peter, kill and eat. Rise, Peter, kill and eat. Get up, Peter, kill and eat. Go ahead, have bacon with your eggs in the morning, have that ham sandwich for lunch, have the pork chop for dinner. That must have felt like fingernails on a chalkboard for Peter, because he was very proud of his diet. He had a long list of dietary restrictions his whole life, and I love his response to this statement. Verse 14, by no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean. Oh, nice move, Peter. Just tell God what to do. And can't you kind of hear the self-righteous pride in his voice right there? Oh, I've never done anything like that. I'd never eat the things on that sheet, Lord. And he just didn't get it, that God was into tearing down these walls and building bridges. So God gives him the vision a second time to help him get it. And then God gives him the vision a third time to help him get it. And then the text says, jump down to verse 19, and while Peter was pondering the vision, the Spirit said to him, behold, three men are looking for you. Rise and go down in this house and accompany them without hesitation, for I have sent them. And as Peter was heading downstairs, I'll bet he was thinking, oh no, they're gonna be Gentiles. I just know they're gonna be Gentiles. God is just so good at taking things we've resisted all of our lives and bringing us face to face with them and saying, do you get it? So Peter goes downstairs and he learns that these guys who are at the door are guys that were sent by this man named Cornelius that he's never met from Caesarea. And Peter does something unheard of in that day. I don't know that we can even begin to appreciate this, the magnitude of this. He invites them in the house, because no Jew would invite a Gentile into their home to be guest. Can you imagine the reaction of the neighbors in this Jewish neighborhood next door looking on at this? You know, the husband's out in his driveway washing his chariots. Wife's planting flowers. He says to her, did you see who just went in the house next door? Yep, there goes the neighborhood. Pretty soon they'll all be moving in here. And that's just the Spirit. Peter had carried this plank in his eye for too long, and it was blinding him to how loved and valuable these people were to God and the extent God had gone to express his love for them. When my wife Barbara and I got married, I had this antique children's bank. It was a cast iron little bank that had been given to me as a child, where you put a penny or nickel in it. It was called a picture gallery bank. And you'd put a penny or nickel in that little guy's hand, and there was a lever on the side of it, and you would pull it, and he would deposit it into the bank. And this particular bank had belonged to a family friend of ours, a very old family friend. It had been her bank when she was a little girl, and before she died, she gave it to me. And I had always had this bank prominently displayed on a shelf in my bedroom, where I intended to continue to prominently display it after Barbara and I got married. But Barbara had different interior design ideas than I did, and she thought it might look nicer displayed in the closet or something. And I said to her, honey, I said, but this is valuable. This is an antique. People collect this stuff. She said, who would want a piece of junk like that? It's ugly. And I said, I know the paint's rubbed off. It's cracked in a number of places. But people, I think it's worth a lot more than you think it is. And she just, oh, you'd be lucky to get $5 at a garage sale for that. And you ought to feel guilty about that. Well, finally, one day, I convinced her to take it to an antique store. And so she walks into this antique dealer, and she says, my husband has this bank he's had since he was a kid. He insists it's worth something. I wonder what you'd give us for it. And the guy looks it over, and he said, I'll give you $120 for it. Now, do you think my wife's going to take $120 for a bank that she would have given away 5 minutes earlier, now that she knows a collector is going to give her $120, a dealer's going to give her $120 for it? Not on your life. She calls me. She's all excited. She says, honey, guess what? Our bank might be worth a lot more. Oh, yeah, now it's our bank. Our bank might be worth a lot more than we thought it was. So now she's all excited. So now we start contacting collectors, and we sent some pictures to a collector in Washington, D.C. He said, I will overnight you a cashier's check for that bank for $2,000. Oh, you think my wife's going to take $2,000 for that bank? Not on your life. To make a long story short, we eventually sold that bank to a collector in Pennsylvania for $4,000. Yeah, aren't you happy for us? The Bible says rejoice with those who rejoice, right? You're like, all of a sudden we were looking through all of our closets going, what other junk do we have in here that we can get rid of? True story, I pulled that picture of the Picture Gallery Bank offline recently. That's identical to the bank that I had, absolutely identical. And recently that bank that you just saw had sold at auction for $52,000. Yeah, so you can see how brilliant we were to sell our bank for $4,000. Now, I told you that story to remind you of a principle that we all know. Value is determined by what somebody's willing to pay for something. The value of that bank was not determined by what it was worth to Barbara, but by what a collector was willing to pay for it. The value of your house is not determined by what an appraiser says it's worth, but ultimately only what somebody is willing to pay for it. Value is determined by what somebody is willing to pay for something. Here's the value of all people. Here's the value of every single person you have ever laid eyes on in your life. Most familiar verse in the Bible, John 3:16. For God so loved the world. How much did he love that he gave? What would he give? What price would he pay? How would he determine value? He would give his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Isn't it true that we can look at some people and we can think, you're not even garage sale material? That's what we think with the plank in our eye. But God looks at him and says, oh no. I'm going to let my only son die on a plank on Good Friday. And I'm going to establish once and for all their value and their worth. That's how valuable you are. I would give my only son for you. Some of you really need to hear that today. You need to be reminded of that you are loved by God to that extent. The next day, Peter travels back with these guys to Caesarea that Cornelius had sent. And I wonder what he was thinking as he traveled with these Gentiles. You know, remember, he hadn't spent time with people not like him. And I wonder if he wasn't thinking, hey, these guys aren't so bad. They're normal. They're interesting to talk to. I've missed out on this all my life. They're real human beings. And then when they arrive at the house of Cornelius, his relatives and close friends are gathered there. There's a whole group of people at Cornelius' house. And Peter is faced with a defining decision. Would he enter the house of Cornelius or not? Because remember, for a Jew to enter a Gentile home would be considered to defile them. He'd have to bust through a wall, kind of spiritually speaking, to walk through that doorway. Once he did, everything would change. It will cost him his self-righteousness. It will cost him his reputation in many circles. It will cost him his pride. And fully aware of the price that he would pay, Peter walks through the door. What a moment. And he finds himself in the minority for the first time in his life. Verse 25. When Peter entered, Cornelius met him, fell down at his feet, notice this, and worshiped him, worshiped Peter. Now, Peter could have really played this up, you know, kind of, yes, yes, bless you, my son, kiss the ring of the apostle, doctor, reverend, great fisherman, Peter, right here, something like that. But to his credit, he didn't do that. Verse 26, but Peter lifted him up, saying, stand up, I too am a man. I really like that. I'm just a guy like you. I'm just a man. I'm struggling. I'm growing like you. I don't have it all together. Hey, we're both in need of God's grace here. Well, there's this fantastic conversation that takes place, and Cornelius shares with Peter all about that vision he had from God to send people to get him, and then the lights go on for Peter. Jump all the way down to verses 34 and 35. So Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality." Everybody say, "No partiality." "But in every nation, anyone," everybody say the word anyone, "anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him." Anyone. Let me ask you, in your soul of souls, have you come to that realization yet? That God shows no partiality. That anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. No matter the race, no matter the background, no matter the political party, no matter the group. Peter goes on and he shares the gospel of Jesus Christ with Cornelius and his household, people he wouldn't have even talked to a few days earlier, wouldn't have eaten with. And an amazing thing starts to happen as you read the text. They start to believe. They start to come to faith. And God's power, God the Holy Spirit, shows up. And Cornelius and his family, they start speaking in languages that they hadn't even learned, this supernatural gift from the Holy Spirit. And I think Peter must have thought back to Acts chapter 2 when he and the other apostles started speaking in languages that they hadn't learned, and the lights go on for him. And in verse 47, he says, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have, just as we experienced on that day in Jerusalem?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. This was the first Gentile baptism service that we know of that had ever occurred. There had never been a Gentile baptism before this. And then they asked Peter to stay a few extra days. And what an experience that must have been. Maybe for the first time in his life, he has a ham sandwich or shrimp cocktail or sweet pickles or something like that. So here's my take on the conversion of Cornelius. There's actually two conversions going on here. There's the conversion of Cornelius and his household, and there's the bigger conversion going on of Peter himself. As God opens his eyes to see that God's heart, God's house, God's son, God's love, God's grace is for everyone. I don't know where you're at in your spiritual journey right now. I don't know whether you love God or hate God, love church or hate church, but I do know this. If your picture of God is anything less than unconditional love for you, you have an inaccurate picture of God. His love is for frat boys and girls gone wild. His love is for kids that have been showing up for Sunday school since the day they were born and those who've never been through the door of a church in their life. His love is for those with special needs and for victims of rape. His love is for Hell's Angels, bikers, and gang members, and for people who are counting their days clean and sober. His love is for refugees and immigrants. His love is for firefighters and farmers and truck drivers and stockbrokers and single moms and rednecks and seminary graduates. His love is for people with secret lives or a stagnant faith. His love is for politicians and factory workers and tattoo parlor owners and meth dealers and foster kids and prisoners in our jails. His love is for families that are falling apart and families that are pretending that they have it all together. His love is for everyone, and his love is for you. That's who our God is, right? So strangely, as Barbara and I started to get to know our neighbors, we started to love them, and we started to recognize what the spiritual stakes were for them in their life, what was hanging in the balance for eternity. And so we just started praying, "God, would you use us somehow in their lives?" And every day we were just praying, could we plant a seed? Could we water a seed? And we just thought, you know, given where they're at spiritually, it's probably going to be like 5 years before we make any progress, maybe get them into the door of a church for the first time. And about a year after living in that neighborhood, we lived there for about a year, 9/11 happened. And those of you who are old enough to remember 9/11, that will remember the weekend after that horrific event, churches all across the U.S. were just jam-packed. I think everybody in America went to church that weekend because we were grieving as a nation and there was nothing else to do. No airplanes were allowed to be flying. No sporting events were happening. All the football games were canceled. Everybody was in church that weekend. So we had our 9 o'clock service in Las Vegas that morning, and I was back in my office kind of getting my notes together for the next service and regrouping, and Barbara walks in and she's in tears. And she said, "You'll never guess who I just sat with." And I said, "Who?" And she said the name of our heathen neighbors next door. And I said, "What?" She said, "Yeah." She goes, "I was just walking into the doors of church this morning, and they were walking in at the same time, and so we sat together." And what we didn't know, because we hadn't talked to them for several days, was that the best man in their wedding, who had stood up with them at their wedding, had been killed in the collapse of one of the World Trade Center towers in New York City. And they were hurting. They were grieving. And they sensed a need for God, and thought they ought to go to church. They didn't know of a church. We were the only church that they knew of, so they just showed up. Heathen showed up. And, you know, I didn't know that they were there that morning, and during the service, they were, like, sitting back in a balcony, and I said, "You know, if any of you have been personally affected this week by the events in D.C. or Pennsylvania or New York City, would you just stand? We want to pray for you today." And what I didn't know, my neighbors were back there standing for prayer. And then I said, "If somebody," quite a number of people stood, actually, and I said, "If somebody's standing near you right now, would you just reach out and put a hand on them, just to encourage them while we pray for them right now?" And so what I don't know is my neighbors are standing for prayer. Barbara's got her hands on them praying for them. They're crying. She's crying. I couldn't believe it. Well, after the 11 o'clock service that morning, I'm kind of making my way through the hallways, just trying to encourage and bless as many people as I could. And all of a sudden, I look down the hall, and I see my Jewish neighbor from across the street coming right at me. I think, "What is going on?" And she comes up to me. Her name's Stacy, and she gave me a great big bear hug. She had tears in her eyes. And she said, "Oh, Gene," she said, "you have no idea what being here today has meant to me." Friends, I watched God use that horrible tragedy in our nation to be the catalyst, to be the spiritual turning point in the lives of our neighbors. When we left Las Vegas a few years later, we had many difficult goodbyes. We had a difficult goodbye to a church family that meant everything to us, that I'd served for 18 years. We had a difficult goodbye to Barbara's family. She was born and raised in Las Vegas. All her family was there. We had a difficult goodbye to our oldest son, who was finishing college there. But do you know the thing that we were completely unprepared for that took us by surprise? Is that our most difficult goodbye was to our neighbors, who we used to think we didn't have anything in common with, but who God used to open our eyes and our hearts to understand that his heart and his house and his son and his grace and his love is for everyone. Friends, God's dream for his church has always been that it would be an everyone kind of place. That we would love our neighbors, that we would build bridges to messy, broken people who are different than us. You see, a gospel that isn't for everyone everywhere really isn't a gospel for anyone anywhere. Now, don't misunderstand what I'm saying. That doesn't mean that we're not going to have some sincere disagreements with our neighbors. It doesn't give us permission to compromise truth. We're to speak the truth in love. But it does mean that we don't label, we don't slam dunk, we don't write other people off, we don't make demeaning comments about others. Because when we make demeaning comments about other people, we are demeaning the very God in whose image they are made, and that's sin. It's just wrong. You know, Easter's coming, just a couple weeks away. It's an opportunity, I'm telling you, to invite, to engage in spiritual conversations in the weeks ahead, to engage with neighbors, families, people that you care about, people that you know what the stakes are. Sometimes we just forget, don't we? I'm always amazed by the way God uses Easter services to help people find the gospel. I want you to know something about your neighbors, something about the people, your colleagues at work, the people you go to school with, who seem so disinterested in spiritual things, maybe people in your family who seem so cynical on religion and Christianity in general, and oftentimes for a lot of good reasons. I want you to know deep down, they really are interested. Show of hands on something, every campus. How many of you have ever played the game hide and seek? Let's all raise our hand. Yes, just about all of us. We know how to play hide and seek. What's the object of hide and seek? The object of hide and seek is to hide so well that you don't get found, right? Now, question, did you ever really want to hide so well that you didn't get found? I mean, is like there anybody out there, been 20 years now, nobody's found me. No, you wouldn't go 5 minutes, and what would you do? Boop. Psst. You'd stick out a hand, you'd stick out a foot. You'd say, ah, shucks, you found me. Let me tell you something about your friends, your neighbors, your colleagues that seem so disinterested, like they don't want to be found. If you look closely, there's a hand out. There's a foot out. Deep down, they want to be loved by God. Deep down, they know they need grace. Deep down, they want to have a purpose and a future. And you and I have the enormous responsibility and the greatest privilege in the world to announce to them that God's love and God's heart and God's house and God's grace and God's Son is for everyone. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's bow our heads together. God, I thank you that your grace is big enough for a sinner like me. You would love me. And God, forgive me when I have a wall-building heart, when I judge people, when I demean people who are made in your image, who you love and whose value you established by giving your one and only Son on a cross. God, I thank you for this church. I thank you for people who have a heart for you, a heart for their friends and neighbors. And God, may we be people who are known to build bridges across divides, who love unconditionally, who love irrationally, like you have loved us. And God, I pray that even in the weeks ahead, I pray that even through the Easter season, people that we know, that we encounter, that we interact with, that we'd be able to plant seeds, water seeds, and that you in your time would bring a harvest, that you'd bring a great increase. And we ask it all in Jesus' name and for his sake. And everybody said, amen. Thank you, Harvest. It's been a joy to serve with you today. God bless all of you.